This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, today we have on Dreamland what I'm thinking is probably going to be a pretty remarkable show. Jimmy Blanchette is with us. Jimmy is a radio expert, a longtime ham operator, and as you can tell by his website address, which is kk6fah.com. Now, why would it be that? It's because it's his handle, is a ham operator. And he is intensely interested in contact and, quite frankly, has achieved a lot. When we were talking to Mark Sims a couple of weeks ago, I brought up this radio, and members of the Dreamland, on the Unknown Country website, Unknown Country subscribers have been talking about it ever since. This is a little radio called a Baofeng. It's an inexpensive two-way radio you can buy on the internet or from Broadcast Supply Worldwide or Amazon or somewhere like that. Now, in my case, the radio is acting a little differently than it does normally. Jimmy, can you tell us what should happen when you turn this radio to the frequency 144.100?
First of all, thank you. Thank you, Whitley, for having me on the show. I really appreciate the opportunity and the opportunity to share this message. So thanks a lot. So these radios really are capable of doing a lot of different things that most people are not aware of. First, they are capable of communicating very far. Literally, the signals coming from these, even these small radios, will reach the moon. I can explain that a little bit further. But to answer your question directly, when we turn on the radio, normally, if you are not doing any contact work, that radio should be silent, unless there is a strong source of interference around or something that could trigger it. That would be typical. Or obviously, if there is a station or somebody talking on that frequency, obviously, you will be receiving a signal.
Now, I've never heard anyone talking on the frequency. You can hear the frequency announcer. This says it's frequency such and such. When you turn it on, but then there's never any talking.
That's right. Yeah, well, that is a frequency that's typically used for space communication. So, that should be a very quiet frequency with nothing happening on it, really.
Well, let's see what happens when I turn it on.
So it is clearly picking up something.
Yes, it's picking up something. All right. Well, now I have one of these, which is it will tell me what frequencies are active in the house when I turn it on. And I've never seen anything on 144.100 at all. So there's that frequency isn't active when the radio is functioning. Is this the right type of equipment to use, or should I get something else?
Yeah, there's a number of equipment that are helpful to try to shed light on this. This is certainly something that will do a good job. Some use just typical RF meter to measure, the field strength around what's going on.
You see, so there's clearly, nothing.
Yeah, clearly it's clearly interacting with something. It's clearly interacting. Something is triggering it. There's a number of tests, and we'll certainly cover it in more detail later on. There's a number of tests that can be performed in order to eliminate false positive and try to understand really, is it a Is it something that's man-made or something that's non-human? And there are pretty good ways to, you know, clarify that and have clarity on that. And we can talk about that in detail. Absolutely. We've done a lot of different tests. I've done tests for over 4 years, really, nearly 4 years that I worked on this. I work on developing this contact modality. This is not, you know, new per se. There have been experiences and folks in, you know, many years ago that have been using radio as a way to communicate with non-human intelligences. But this is not something that's currently mainstream, or, you know, there's not really a lot of information about
it.
It's
not mainstream at all.
So,
not at all.
So we'll be able to shed a lot of light on this. Certainly, we can cover there's a science aspect of this, technical science aspect of this, and the consciousness aspect of this when we get into interacting with non-human intelligences. So we have good material. I have, you know, several slides and visual that we can use, and also there's a video montage that I put together. That essentially it's a collection of many video clips that I have gathered over the years doing this work, and not alone, by the way. This has been tested and verified worldwide. Really, this contact modality. Shortly after I had my first contact experience, and I could, you know, I was sure of what was happening here in terms of the, you know, the non-human intelligence aspect of this. I shared with several experiencers, very serious experiencers around the world. And they also started using the technique and had their own experience, and they also gathered, you know, evidence and so forth. And so this has been, this contact modality has been really validated all over the world, from New Zealand, Australia, Europe, of course, United States, Canada, even Antarctica. You have video footage of an experience that was in Antarctica.
Well, what happens in here, in this house, is essentially a constant state of contact. Mm-hmm. The last time I had any interaction with any unseen entity was about half an hour ago, when I was working on a meditation I've been working on, and briefly fell asleep because the book I was working on is really dense and difficult to read, and it involves a lot of hieroglyphics, and it's a challenge, you know, and I just was tired, and immediately something gave a gentle electrical shock to one of my toes, and this is, and woke me right up to continue working. This is life in this apartment. It's life. It's my life. It's like this all the time. And frankly, I love it. I mean, it's extraordinary, and I'm very glad it's like this. However, we all want to know more, and I'm not alone in that. So what I want to do is to circle back to when this started with you, because you're as advanced as anyone on Earth, I think, I can safely say this, in the process of using radio as a contact modality. And with this little radio that's acting so strangely, I didn't mention, by the way, folks, some of these radios can be put into a microwave or even into a Faraday bag, and they still pick up the signal. Not here. If I walk toward the kitchen where the microwave is, the signal turns itself off immediately. If I get a Faraday bag out, which I've got some, the signal will generally turn itself off as soon as I start to put the radio in the bag. Which gets me back to the fact that my listeners all know, an entire lifetime of trying to get proof, and I always get just within an inch, and then I don't get it.
Yeah.
All right. So now let's circle back. You're younger. you're thinking about this. Why do you decide to start trying to do this?
Good question. From a very early age, I'm born, by the way, in Quebec, Canada, northern Quebec, Canada, really in a farmland, very small village, very remote location. And very early on, I was, I always felt connected to the universe and always wanted to expand my horizons. And so that's how I learned about amateur radios, and I became very interested and passed my license at 12 years old, at an early age. And that was a way for me to open myself up to the world and communicate with the world and expand really myself, being, kind of stuck in a small village, if you will. And so that's how my, my passion for amateur radio started many years ago. Felt always very connected to the universe. I was highly interested in astronomy, astrophysics, and so forth, and kept really working on the little of the technical aspect of the amateur radio and built many antennas over the years for a lot of different purposes. And parallel to that technical aspect, if you will. I've had many, many out-of-body experiences since I was also very young.
Could you describe one of them, or what they're like for you,
sure.
In general?
Absolutely. Typically, I feel really coming out of my. It's like my energy body, being extracted from my physical body, and I have a complete. Awareness of that process when that happens. It's very intense. It's very special too, because the state we're in is very different than in the physical state when we are in that energetic state, obviously. Typically, I get out of my body, and very shortly after, most of the time I black out. I don't have recollection of what happened after, but I'm very clear recollection of getting out of my body.
Do you get yourself out, or are you taken out?
Well, in the early days, it was a spontaneous phenomenon. And I thought it was a normal thing, because I talked about it with my brother at the time, and he was also having sleep paralysis and this type of experience. And I said, it must be normal, right? Everybody must be experiencing sleep paralysis and so forth. But then later on, the experience became a bit different. I recall a very intense and somewhat traumatic experience when I was in the early year 2000, actually. And I had an out-of-body, I was in my bed face down, and I couldn't move. I had a sleep paralysis. I was fully awake and aware. I was in that state, and I could literally hear very close to me around the bed movement. I could feel, hear, as if there were somebody or entity or something there that was moving around me. But I was completely paralyzed, face down. I couldn't see what was happening, and I was terrified at the time, quite honestly.
Why were you terrified? I don't get it.
I very much remember that experience. And it's just later on now that I started understanding what probably was happening at the time. But at that time, many years ago, I had no experience with contact work or whatsoever. So I could not relate this to anything, really.
Yeah, I was in the same boat when I was a kid. The same thing was happening to me. And I've been out of my body many times, and in fact, people have even seen and interacted with me when I was in that state, but I can't really do it myself. I'm taken out. But now, speaking of being taken out, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to have to take you out of the show for a few minutes while you have a nice little break. And the nicest thing about this break is we're going to suggest all sorts of things to you. We're going to suggest that you buy my books. We're going to suggest that you go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe. You're probably not going to do either of those things, but we're going to ask you anyway. We'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is, and it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. We're talking to Jimmy Blanchette. His easily memorized website is kk6fah.com. Those are the call letters, Jimmy's call letters. He's an active, very active ham radio operator who's capable of doing some pretty amazing things, not the least of which is bouncing signals off the moon. But Jimmy, so you're a young guy now. You've had strange experiences. Sleep paralysis or something has been happening to you. You feel the sense of an entity in the room when you're younger. How old were you when that happened?
My first out-of-body experience, I mean, really from as young as I can remember, they became more intense. I became kind of more aware of, or I felt it kind of more intensely, I think, later on over the years. The one I spoke about, you know, that sleep paralysis with the entities or the movement around my bed, really was when I was in my 20s. And so, this has been present with me all my life. And so if we fast forward to, you know, closer to today, so I was, again, very interested always in the subject of life elsewhere in the universe. It was obviously inconceivable to me that we were alone. Not even a question. It's inconceivable that we're alone. The probability of that is zero, of that we're alone. That's at least the way I perceived it.
It's true. We're not alone. We don't know what in what way we're being visited. Like, these signals, where do they come from? Do they come from aliens? Do they come from our own dead, or a parallel universe, or are they just I don't think that what's happening in my case can be described as something that is really explainable, because I've turned off the electrical inputs into this apartment on the wall, so that there is no electricity coming in. Nothing whatsoever is turned on. And the signal continues just like it did. You heard it before.
Yeah.
So it's not some kind of normal interference. It may be interference of some kind, but it's certainly not anything coming from this apartment. And downstairs, a man lives down there with his little boy, and they just have a normal place. So.
Yeah. There's a, and we can certainly talk further offline to run the additional test, that's for sure. But yeah, there are ways to eliminate, you know, let's say the human aspect of this, and you know, it takes some time and all that. We'll cover that in more detail if you wish. I have a few slides. I don't know if we could.
Yeah, let's and folks who are listening on audio, I'll describe the slides as Jimmy puts them up. Okay. Go ahead, Jimmy. What would you like to do?
Okay, so I will share my screen. Here we go.
There you go.
All right.
Okay, what the slide says, first contact, communication with non-human intelligences using electromagnetic radio waves, Jimmy Blanchett, March 18th, 2021. We're Excellent. All eyes and ears, Jimmy.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I will move this a little bit on the side here. Okay. So let me start with this one here. The primary objective really of this effort is really to deploy a game changer contact modality that anyone can use and try to make their first contact with non-human intelligence in a way that's effective, in a way that's repeatable, in a way that's very clear, that it's, you know, nothing else. You know, I've been working closely with, as I said, several people around the world. Most recently, I've been working really closely with a good friend of mine and somebody I collaborate with to spread the message, with Mark Sims, whom you've spoke to already.
Yeah, we had him on the show.
That's right. And so there's really a big push right now to get this information out because it's very important. And so let me go through a few of the bullet points here. You know, this, I also want to specify this use of this technology, these radios, is really, I like to describe these radios more as a technological aid, you know, to assist us in our quest to expand our consciousness, and in this case, yes, expand it with non-human intelligences. You know, although what we're going to talk about is very kind of bolt and nut in some way, because, you know, it's very, you know, it's hardware, it's technology, human technology.
Yeah, in Canada, it's bolts and nuts. In the U.S., it's nuts and bolts.
That's right. I want to be clear that the phenomenon that what's driving really this phenomenon is really consciousness. For the folks, yes, who've been in this field for that experience in this field, I think it becomes very obvious after a while, and it's really the case. So I want to point it out. This is just an aid, a technological aid to help us make these connections.
To let us know someone is there, essentially.
Exactly. And once that connection is established, that connection stays. And that's where the journey starts. And it's different for everyone. You know, typically people have their own experience based on their situation and so forth. And so it's really a starter, really, to get started and establish a contact and then expand. In my case, it's been very transformative in every aspect of the word. And I know many other people who've had this experience has been very transformative.
Something has happened in the past couple of days that is related to this show. I've actually just realized as you were talking that it's related, and that is that I have been given a meditation technique which is apparently very ancient. It goes back to the first religious texts, mm-hmm, which I think is also probably the last text of soul science, mm-hmm, in the pyramid of Unas from 3000 BC. And I'm going to put this meditation up on unknowncountry.com and on the YouTube channel to be a companion piece to our show, because it's one thing to be able to get to the point where you can identify that you have an awareness that is responding to you, and you can see that with some kind of communications tool. Right. The next step is the most important one, to engage with that consciousness.
Right.
And now, so tell us a little bit about the Moon Bounce project that you have up here. Folks who are listening on audio only, he's going to give us what he describes as a brief history of space communication, capability. And in this is a picture of a very dramatic looking antenna pointing at the sky called a triangular array rotatable polarity, or TARP antenna. And it goes through moon bounce technology, moons working on a homemade, the rotatable antenna, then a mystical experience in guarding first contact in 2015. And Jimmy, why don't you take it from there?
Thank you, Whitley. So if we fast forward from my childhood to 2013, when I heard about moon bounce communication at the time, I had really never heard about it, quite honestly. It's a very exotic type of communication that's done by really a very small number of people in the world of experienced amateur radio operators. So I heard about it, and I became very interested by the challenge in 2013. And the technique consists in, as you described, is to use the moon as a passive reflector. And essentially a beam, powerful, very high power beam of electromagnetic radio waves at the moon. And the wave essentially reflects or bounces back towards, it's scattered in all directions, but a portion of these radio wave comes back towards Earth. And so this way, if there's an amateur radio operator set up somewhere else on a planet with the right equipment, right frequency, then we can establish a two-way communication. It's a very challenging mode of communication. The round trip is nearly half of a million miles in distance. And typically, the communication that's performed is digital only, not voice, because the signals are too weak to be, heard. Typically the signals are not even audible with the human ear. And I know that sounds incredible, but the signals typically are buried in the background noise. But with the computer today and the technology, we're able to detect these very weak signals and decode them. Right? That's the foundation, if you will, of the technique. This requires very specialized equipment, a lot of very sensitive equipment, again, to detect the signal and so on. So I started in 2013. I started building my own antenna setup, I worked on this top project really from the better part of 2014, 2016 to develop this triangular array rotatable polarity antenna system to enable this communication technique. I was successful. I mean, early on, I had my first contact in 2013, but again, I wanted to expand and develop the technique, so I kept improving, my station, and I came up with this antenna concept. And there's a little story, actually, that's interesting, I think, that I should probably point out how this design came to me. The design came to me, I was at the beach at the time. I know that may sound weird. I was at the beach, and just like literally in a download, this model came to my mind, this triangular model. And so I jumped off my beach chair and ran to my apartment, and where I had my computer, and I started modeling this configuration, this geometry. I do have a specialized software to that models any kind of antenna. We can essentially insert all the configuration in the software, and the software will spit out or will output what the radiation pattern is going to be based on the antenna model. And what came out was really amazing. It was a very pure radiation pattern using this triangular configuration. And so it was kind of so unique that I ended up writing and two scientific papers on this antenna. I have it in the next slide. We'll show some of it, okay. Which were published in a magazine, a German magazine in Europe. So it was a unique configuration.
On this slide, it goes with 2013, the first two-way communication via moon bounce. Then 2014 to 2016, the development of the TARP antenna. Then 2015, mystical experience regarding first contact. What was that about, Jimmy?
So this was, in 2015, I had a guided meditation. It was the first guided meditation I experienced, really. And I was invited in that guided meditation to visualize a light table and to ask my guides to join me. At that light table that I was essentially projecting into my consciousness. So I went along with the exercise, and surprisingly, there were three beings that showed up, really appeared and manifested themselves at that light table. There was one that was very tall, very bright, made of light, literally, and two other beings that would be hard to describe, my words, but there were really three beings, and then the lady was driving the guided meditation, invited me to ask what was my purpose in life, and so I again went along with the exercise. I was, thinking that I was probably just imagining all this. And so even at the moment that I formulated the question, obviously, with my consciousness, and the two words that came, the first reply that came back was, you already know what your purpose in life is. Why are you asking? So I was very surprised by that answer.
I can imagine.
And immediately after that, there are two words that literally appeared before me, and these two words were first contact. And I had a very, very strong feeling when I experienced this that it's hard to describe, but it felt like very real. It felt very real and felt like really something that I was connected to. But again, at the time in 2015, I had no contact experience whatsoever. I was working on this antenna system. I had a very strong feeling that this antenna system will be related to that, but I had no idea how to relate that, right? What means first contact? There are many different interpretations of that word, obviously. And so I left it at that, really. I left it at that, but I was just very impressed by that experience. Very intense experience. But again, I had a very strong feeling that this technology I was working on was related to that, but I couldn't go further with that. And so,
well, just to stop for a moment, Free Dreamlanders, I have a very strong feeling right now that you're going to be watching and listening to some commercials, so enjoy yourselves, but above all, do the deed. Go to unknowncountry.com and do the deed or whatever else we ask you to do, even if we ask you to dance in the street. Go ahead and do it. Respond to the commercials. We'll be right back. Unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.
We're talking to Jimmy Blanchette. His website, kk6fah.com. And Jimmy has been talking about a kind of a parallel experience of evolving and designing radio devices that would help him make contact, and describing the mystical experiences that went along with that, which is quite extraordinary. It's the first time I think I've ever had anyone on this radio show except Mark Sims who could describe that, although I know there must be plenty of people who are doing it, and I'm looking for others to talk to. Now we go on, Jimmy, to, on your slide, 2017, first contact made on May 1st, 2017. Can you tell us that story?
Absolutely. So let me move forward a couple of slides here to support this discussion. Okay. These were, by the way, the papers that were published in 2016 and 17 about TARP. And it made very fortunate, made the cover page of that magazine actually at the time. In December 2016, so we see it here. Just want to describe this also. This is a representation of what we talked about earlier in terms of moon bounce
technology. Right. He's showing a slide, for those of you who are listening, of radio waves being bounced off the moon from basically from your backyard. Is that right?
That's right. Exactly right.
Incredible.
And this is a little bit of representation how the TARP system, how it radiates the electromagnetic radio wave, right? So typically antennas will radiate in all directions. They're called omnidirectional antennas. This system is designed to create a beam, like a laser beam, where all the energy is kind of focused in just very small laser beam, which can be the best analogy I will have, all these small laser pointer that we use sometimes. Right. They're very low power, but
Laser pointers have been a big factor in contact. I know that Stephen Greer uses laser pointers in contact, and in fact, one of the earliest events I know of where there was a physical contact generated from our side was when Bootsy Galbraith and Stephen Greer worked together with laser pointers in Mexico, and they got response. These craft would show up, or these lights would show up. But for the audio listeners, we're looking at is a slide of his antenna, which is a three-pronged antenna, and you can see the pulses of radio waves going off of the antenna in a specific direction, while beside it there's a schematic of a regular antenna that will be broadcasting in all directions. But go ahead, Jimmy. Let's keep on with the story.
Sure. So how I got my first contact in May 2017, what led to that is I started, after I built the antenna system, I started my interest in the modality called CE5 or close encounter of the fifth time. I became very interested in the subject, and I saw a video on the internet. And again, I was always naturally very passionate about this in the first place. So I said, well, I'm going to try this. I'm going to absolutely try this. Why not? And it made sense, obviously, with the equipment that I had and the capability to maybe try to leverage this technology to see if I could get some help from all this radio equipment I had. And so I wanted to do that with a bigger group and so forth. So I was looking for a contact site where this could be done. And I had located a site in Los Padres National Park. And I said, okay, I will go there, by myself and just to kind of scout the place, scout the location.
Now, why did you locate, why this particular site?
it's far away from human installations. It's a very quiet place in the middle of a national park, so it is a good spot to have clear sky without light pollution, and it made sense really to select a location like that to do the contact work. So I spotted the site, and I decided to go scout the place. But before we're doing that, I said, why not use the radio technology to try to broadcast my intent to do this? And so I created a binary code message to essentially invite visitors to join me or give me a sign of their presence at that specific location. I had the binary code message contained latitude, longitude, date, time, exactly when I was intending to be at the site. And so I created a binary code message, and I broadcasted it. I blasted it throughout the solar system using this TARP antenna radio setup.
So you would point the TARP antenna in different directions, and
correct. I transmitted towards all the planets in our solar system, including the sun and the moon.
Now, how did you transform the message? I conceivably would think of a written message into a radio signal.
Yes, good question. Well, the initial message was a binary code, so I converted essentially the text message, if you will, into an audio message, a binary code audio message. This was the early days before I refined the technique. I use a different technique now. So that was an audio message. I do have a recording of it. I don't know if I can play it on the screen here, but it is essentially a binary code message here that I played, which lasts about 30 seconds. And that binary code message contained, again, latitude, longitude, date, and time where I will be. So transmitted that days prior going to the site, the contact site. And then I went along and just went to the contact site. Again, I was alone by myself. I had brought the little handheld radio with me, which was set to the same frequency that I had used for, the transmission of this binary code message. So I had that with me, and so I arrived at the site. It was a beautiful place near a lake, beautiful sky, no light pollution. And so I said that would be a perfect spot to bring people and do contact work here. Now, maybe 15-20 minutes after arriving at the site, I had initially put my small handheld radio on the roof of my car, and I said, I will just sit in a chair and try to meditate a little bit and relax and enjoy the place, really. It was a beautiful place, very calm at night. And 15-20 minutes into this meditation, the radio started interacting, started going off for no reason. I had this radio for many months. I had used it for satellite communication for all kind of purpose. I had, you know, I'd carried that radio with me everywhere, and it had never done this before. And here I was in the middle of a national park, in the middle of nowhere, and the radio starts going off by itself. There's, you know, in this remote location where there is no cell signal of any kind, it's too far away from everything. So on the moment when this happened, I was very intrigued, but I said there must be something wrong with the radio, or maybe it's too cold outside. I did not make the connection really on the moment that it was a reply, but it was very intriguing to me. So this is how the first night really happened, and I left very intrigued, went back home, and you know, the next day I tried to replicate this phenomenon on my handheld radio. Technically, I have obviously a lot of electronic equipment. I said, let's try to replicate this, and I was unable to replicate that interaction, unable. And I decided to, I said, okay, maybe, you know, there's an interference or something. So, you know, to do due diligence, I kept the radio with me, you know, on my belt, and just put my shirt over it, and just kept it the during the week, you know, going to the grocery store, going to the bank, doing my thing, to see if the radio will start interacting this way again, right? If it will be triggered by any kind of interference or something, the radio should do that, right? More in a city than in the middle of a national park, obviously, right? That was my logic. Nothing happened. Radio stayed completely silent. And so I, 2 weeks later, I repeated the experience. I decided to go back to the contact site again. And again, prior to going there, I broadcasted my intent, the message, and, you know, I said, maybe I'm going to see something. But I had, you know, again, a very intrigued by the radio thing, and I was also, I had read on the internet and read through the CE5 groups, you know, how sometimes the non-human intelligence will interact with electronic devices, right? And so I [S2] Yes. [S1] Started, you know, having a suspicion here that really this maybe what had happened. But again, I'm a scientist at heart. I do have I'm a chemist, by the way, from, you know, my education. I'm a scientist and a strong background in engineering, and so there's no way I would have concluded you know, that it was from ETs or non-human intelligence without having done all the necessary due diligence to eliminate all possibility of false positive and so forth. So went back to the site 2 weeks later, and the same thing happened again. The radio started going off, and it was very clear on that second experience that there was an interaction going at that moment. And so I made the connection, and I realized what was happening. So this is how this started, really. It was... you know, it was very obviously shocking at the time. I mean, when you have this experience for the first time, I had no contact prior contact experience. So this was transformative, and especially I, you know, from that point on, actually ended up doing this contact experience alone. And so it was very, you know, intense to have this experience in the middle of the night, in the middle of the national park, and having this kind of interactions.
Quite a few of the listeners to this show will know about how intense that actually is, including the host. We're very familiar with that experience.
Absolutely. And so I do have, on this slide, I do have a video here. And, you know, what I'm going to do, I don't think I can play it here easily, because when we share the screen, going into the video mode, I think will be challenging. But what I can do, maybe, you know, we can add the video after the fact.
Yeah, well, it's essentially the same radio that I'm holding up right now. And what happens is the same thing that's going to happen when I turn it on, which is... That's what happens, isn't it?
Right. Yes, exactly. It's very similar to that.
Here it happens all the time.
Right. Is exactly that. So that's how the radio interacted. And there was I could hear frequencies also in it was not only static noise.
You could hear frequencies in it too.
I could hear tones, clearly tones, but I didn't have the equipment obviously in the field to detect that. And and so on. So so let me go to the...
It's 2:16 in the morning. The radio is very active right now.
Next slide, yes.
Yeah, Ed, you know, the way that intermittent flashing is, have you ever tried to determine if it's a code?
Oh yes. We'll get to that, but yes, it's not, you know, some people will say, oh, it sounds like Morse code and so forth. It's not Morse code, I can tell you. It's not Morse code.
Well, I know it's not Morse code. I know Morse code well enough to know that.
Yeah, it's not Morse code.
Yeah.
But it's not, let me put it this way, it's not because we don't understand or we can't readily decode the message that there's no information contained in the message. Let's put it this way. For instance, it is very easy, and I've done this to demonstrate that you can literally encode a full message with pictures in white noise, and that white noise will just sound really like we just heard, like static kind of white noise, and that white noise can contain tremendous amount of information. And
well, this mm-hmm. may contain a lot of information that we're not. Have you tried things like slowing it
yes,
down?
Yes, I did experiments to try to decode the contents, and there are some energy signatures, and I call them energy signatures because they're different type of interactions that this radio will undergo. From, you know, one could postulate different non-human intelligence producing their own energy signature, and I've studied this, and there are frequencies in some energy signatures that are embedded frequencies, and these frequencies to my, there's one energy signature, for instance, which I call the eight tones, contains eight different tones of frequencies. And interestingly, when we run this spectrogram of this audio recording, we do a spectrographic analysis, these frequencies, interestingly, the frequency themselves can be reduced to, numerologically, to the number of 3, 6, or 9. Most of the frequencies end up being reduced to number 9, which I found really fascinating.
Yeah, I should say so. Because
that's
of the
right.
Significance
for those who
of
know
that
about
number.
The work of Tesla and the Vortex Mathematic, this is what's, you know, really behind all this. So very clearly, there is information contained in some of these energy signatures. Again, I have not spent a lot of time on trying to decode them. I've spent some time. You know, you can spend a lot of time, obviously, doing this work. But it's been very obvious to me that
yes.
there was information. And not only the radio, my experience has been, and we've done extensive tests on this, and some folks also that I'm working with, I've conducted different tests, and our friends Mark Sims, have done tests as well recently. With Faraday bags, I've done tests with Faraday cages using a microwave, for instance. So there's a number of tests that can be done to shed some light onto the nature of these interactions. And what I've learned, what we've learned, is that most of these interactions, when they are obviously driven by non-human intelligence, they defy the laws of physics as we know them. For instance, you can take two identical radios, just like you have, and set them to the very same frequency. And if you do contact work, and let's say you broadcast a message, you know, to establish contact, the non-human intelligence will take control over one radio very specifically, and typically will be the radio that's been used for the transmission, and start interacting with that radio, while the other radio, which is identical, set to the same frequency, will remain completely silent.
I believe Mark Sims made some video of that phenomenon.
Yes, there are videos. I do have probably hundreds of videos showing this, and there's a video montage that I will make available with Lee. You know, it's a 38-minute video montage that shows different all this device behaving completely differently.
And that'll be available to our subscribers on unknowncountry.com.
Yeah.
So another reason, folks, why you should not wait around, because you do understand that this is not fake. That contact is really happening, and this website is a very important part of that. Because I'm living in a state of contact that's permanent, and you're not going to find that anywhere else in the world. So if you're interested in this, you know, listen up and get active, get involved. Okay, now what Jimmy just put up is another slide. It's approximate reach of handheld radio and TARP, and it shows the slide, shows one of the little Baofeng radios, and then the on top, and the TARP antenna, and it shows that the Baofeng radio can reach the moon, and the TARP antenna much farther, 2.5 billion
That's
miles.
That's correct.
So, yeah, I'm explaining this for my audio listeners.
Yes, and so the small handheld radio, as mentioned earlier in the show, most people don't know that, but a single watt of power with a radio like that will reach the moon. The reason why I know that, and I can prove that, I do have a slide here that I would like to show here. So, back in 2014, China sent a probe to the moon, back and forth, a round trip to the moon. It was the 4M probe, the 4N moon mission. And in that probe, they had included, or they had equipped this probe with a transmitter, which had a power of 1 watt, roughly, and a very small vertical antenna. We see it on the screen here. It's just very similar antenna like, you know, we have on this small handheld radio. And as the probe was going to the moon and eventually came back, it was continuously transmitting telemetry and transmitting messages. And we could essentially, with the right equipment like I have here, we could hear and decode and detect these transmissions from Earth. So again, that probe was using 1 watt, almost 300,000 kilometers away, and yet we could hear it here with just, you know, human technology, if you will. So that's just an example here to demonstrate that a single watt of power can travel that distance. So the reverse path is true as well. Obviously, if we transmit a message here on Earth with this small handheld radio, these radio waves in free space will go extremely far and reach the moon and beyond. And this is, again, with human technology. If we consider, obviously, that very advanced civilizations have much more advanced technology, you know, they could certainly detect this transmission even further. So if we're going to go back to that slide here, so this is what that slide expressed, right? So 230,000 miles distance, your radio, when you transmit, you will be heard out there. That's an important thing here to know, because, you know, we tend to think that we talk about the International Space Station, you know, we think it's far in space and all that, but it's within our reach, really, our technological reach. Anyone can reach that. Anyone can have his or her voice being heard that far. And that's one of the key to this this contact modality. That's really one of the key. In the case of TARP, the equipment that I'm using here, obviously because of the power that I'm using and the size of this installation, and by the way, this antenna has the size of my house. It's very large, and I use very powerful amplifiers to broadcast, and so this radio wave will reach will cover really the entire solar system. You know, if I beam the antenna towards Saturn or Jupiter, the radio waves will physically reach Saturn and Jupiter and all the moons that are around them. Jupiter has 67 moons, One of them, Ganymede, is as big as planet Earth, really. Saturn 61. So there's a ton of astronomical bodies out there. So, and that was my, you know, the logic at the time when I made my first transmission. You know, again, I was always convinced we're not alone. But I said, if we are being monitored by any, you know, ET race or non-human intelligence, they should hear that transmission, right? It should stand out. The power of that transmission should stand out of the background noise of the planet. That was the, you know, the logic behind it.
You know, folks, hear the motivation in this effort. This is a man who has been touched by something real. You're not motivated like this. You're not someone like me trying to contact the visitors daily, hourly, for 30 years after my experience, or Jimmy, after his touch, just being touched by this in his childhood in a very oblique way. Look at this effort. This is what matters. This is what will make this happen. This kind of effort on the part of ordinary people. Because believe me, I know the visitors very well. They are not going to be going to the top dogs, because they're not here for that. They're here for us. Okay, Jimmy, we have gotten to the point where our free listeners have to leave us. And so I'm going to say goodbye to them, and we're going to take a brief pause, and then we will continue on going deeper for the subscribers. And what I want to talk about is how to generate a transmission with these small radios, because you can actually take an image and turn it into a transmittable signal, and this works in extraordinary ways. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much, as always, for being with us on Dreamland, and do come back next week. It's a wonderful show, and it is right at the forefront of the most extraordinary thing that has ever happened to mankind.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.